Hi everyone, Erin from the Impatient Gardener here for the last time in 2020. I can't believe we're at the end of this year. I've never had a year simultaneously go so fast and so slow at the same time. And it was a different year in the garden because of everything that was going on in the world. It was just about a year ago that I sat here and showed you my new seed organization system, which, by the way, still love, working out great. I'm about to dig into that seed stash, see what I have so that I can finish up my seed orders for this year. And of course, we'll talk about that as things go on. So after that, we moved into spring gradually. And it was such a crazy time in the world then. You know, the East Coast was really dealing with the pandemic before anybody else in the country was. And I mean, I quickly made baseball caps so that I could cover up the fact that I couldn't get to a hairdresser during that time. And of course, looking back now, it's like looking back, the perspective on it is so much different. You know, if there's one great thing that came out of this year, it's that so many more people discovered gardening. And it has been such a pleasure to talk to new gardeners and people who have been gardening for a while but are just sort of upped their game this year. So spring was kind of crazy. I had this plan percolating for a while, and then I discussed the plan in winter for the new garden area kind of over by the road off our driveway, this new sort of naturalistic style garden. And that was the biggest gardening project I've ever taken on, I think. And there were ups and downs. We had a massive flood that washed away a whole bunch of the soil we had brought in. By the way, a little update to that situation. Our whole road dealt with some really bad issues during that flooding. But in our particular area, which is, you know, what I call the crick or creek, is basically it's just a culvert that runs through a property, and there's our next door neighbor has one, and they all group together and then they go through a neighbor to the east and eventually go out into Lake Michigan. Essentially, it's field runoff from the farm fields up the hill when you get down to the unromantic side of it. We discovered that our neighbor where it outflows, Lake Michigan right now, and has been for a while, is extremely high. So all of these big pipes that are the water that can flow out to Lake Michigan get clogged up because the water is so high, it pushes rocks into those. So we found out from our neighbor that whole pipe was clogged up with rocks. So all this water was coming down the hills, and none of the water could get out to the lake. So everything backed up into our yard. So that's why it was so bad. So it's good that we figured out the problem, and so we know what to look for in the future. It's bad because that's an ongoing issue and we're not really sure how to deal with that. Our neighbor is extremely helpful. He spends thousands of dollars every year hiring someone to come dig those out. It's not something you can really do by hand. So we're just gonna have to keep an eye on that and do what we can to help them out so that we can keep that water moving. That is the update to the flooding situation. It's good to know basically what happened. And our road as a whole has a plan to sort of remedy the situation or at least help it going forward. So we should be good to go from there. So after we got through that whole sort of crazy flood, there were a bunch of other projects that happened in spring. Maybe the project, other than the new garden, which was sort of the focus of the whole gardening year for me, maybe the project that I think stretched me the most, and I'm still maybe the most excited about, is the Belgian fence that I put in the vegetable garden. I think I'm excited about it because I rarely take on projects that require so much patience. I am an instant gratification kind of person, and gardening is teaching me to, you know, relax a little bit on that stuff. But to start an espalier Belgian fence from, you know, twigs that are, I don't know, 3/8 of an inch maybe around, knowing full well that it's going to be several years before it looks like much, was kind of a big thing for me. And you might recall it took a little bit of courage to do that. So that was fun. That project was fun to follow. Everything is doing really well over there with the exception of one of the trees got bit, eaten by rabbits twice, and it's not rebounding as well as the others. Because I did lose some to, I think maybe two or three branches to, I assume, rabbits. So we solved the rabbit problem, I think. And that one's just a little slower to get going. So that's the only one I'm sort of worried about. We'll see how they go through the winter, but that was super exciting. And then, you know, for the rest of the year, it's funny for a person who, I don't know, probably 6 or 7 years ago, swore off roses. I spent an awful lot of time fussing around with roses this year. I removed some roses, that would be from the driveway containers, and planted those pagoda dogwood trees in there, which was the best move I have made in a container, maybe ever. Why I waited so long to change that height there was absolutely perfect. I love those trees. They thrived in those containers. I planted roses, bare root roses, in those containers in the vegetable garden. And then I showed you guys how I overwintered those. I showed you how I overwintered all the other roses. I mean, I don't really know where this rose fascination came with, since I sort of said I wasn't going to grow them anymore. But you know, I can't get over the scent. For me, it's the scent and the beauty of them. I love it. Then in spring, we ran into a bit of an issue where it was time to plant out my sweet peas, but my tulips were still blooming in the vegetable garden. It turned out that most of the sweet peas just did just fine. And actually, those sweet peas bloomed until I cleaned out the vegetable garden. I was still cutting a few sweet peas. If you don't grow sweet peas, they are, for me, they were my sort of gateway plant to starting plants from seed and growing flowers from seed, because it's very hard to find sweet peas to buy pre-grown. So I knew if I wanted sweet peas, I would have to grow them myself, and that's where it started. I can't get over sweet peas. They are so beautiful. They have a smell that is just the best, maybe the best smell, I think, in the garden of any, certainly of any flower I grow, they are the best smelling flower. But they are just so beautiful and romantic. And I love the fact that you have to cut them frequently. So what you end up with, or at least what I end up with, is little bouquets of sweet peas all over my house. And it is just the sweetest. They are well named as sweet peas. So the sweet peas went on. We had to revamp how we were going to grow tulips this year. So we moved them out of those raised beds for next year. And then we got into container planting, which, of course, you guys know that I adore container planting. It's really, I get more excited about that than I do almost anything else in the garden. And this year I had some really, really good successes with the containers. I would say my number one success this year was the purple bell vine that I grew in the containers on the deck. It was the first time I've grown that plant. It's actually a new plant to me. I first learned about it maybe a year before that. What a stunner. So that will feature strongly in my containers for this year, because that is one of the annual vines that I'm going to stick with for a while. Of course, it wasn't all sunshine and roses, even in the garden this year. I did have a few failures, as one does. I planted pumpkins for the first time. I planted them super late. I planted them in a smart pot, which I knew was probably pushing it for pumpkins. I got one pumpkin late in the season. It was this big, and that was the end of my pumpkin. So maybe we'll try again. Maybe we won't. We'll see. I also did videos on a couple of my favorite plants. Clematis were my sort of original love. So I did a big video on clematis, on growing clematis. You guys, the addiction to clematis continues. There will be more on that because I can't stop growing those. And of course, there were dahlias. There were so many dahlias. You guys, I think this year I found that I maxed out how many dahlias I can grow. There might have been too many, and you'll probably never hear me say that again. So I do have some fine tuning to do of how many I can actually reasonably grow. But you know that I love them. There were tons of videos on growing them and storing them and digging them and everything. Everything you could want for a dahlia. And a dahlia tour when they were looking their best. And truly, for me, that is the time of year when my garden looks the best, is since I've invested so much time and space in dahlias, the garden does look its best when they're all blooming, which is great because, to be honest, a lot of gardens are fizzling out by that time of year. So I love the fact that my garden is looking great at that time of year. It was a different summer for me because Normally in summer, I'm out looking at a lot of other gardens. And this year, I only got out to see one other garden, and that was for a really wonderful trip down to Ball Gardens to see their display gardens and see some of the new plants they have coming for next year. And it was the first time in months I had driven really anywhere, maybe the first time I had left the county in a long time. And it was so great to be in a garden again. I take so much inspiration from other gardens that was food for the soul. And even though I only had a few minutes in the middle of the day to shoot a very, you know, sunny video, it was such a pleasure to see that and soak up that inspiration, because I really missed that this year. Because even if I'm not seeing like display gardens or public gardens, I'm visiting other people's gardens, which sometimes is where I draw the most inspiration from. And you know, it was a year where I had some great collaborations as well. So last year in winter, I did a collaboration with Alexandra from the Middle-Sized Garden, which is really fun. And I think we're going to work on something hopefully going forward for this year. It's really interesting for me to follow Alexandra because, first of all, she gets the chance to see and talk to some amazing gardeners and gardens in England. And it's really interesting because we grow a lot of the same plants, but we're in obviously extremely different climates. So it's always fun to get that other perspective. Then I did, two or three videos with my friend Eric from Garden Fork. Two of those were for Troy Built. And it is always fun to work with Eric. We get along well and we have a good time working on those videos together. And I did another video for Troy Built with Serena from Thrift Diving in fall. And that was great to work with Serena for the first time. And then I actually did a few videos, sort of, with Laura from Garden Answer. So first of all, I lost a bet last year for the Rose Bowl when the Oregon Ducks played the Wisconsin Badgers. And so we made a little bit of a bet. I lost a bet, and so I had to plant a Mahonia, which is the state flower of Oregon. And that was fun to do. And then I was fortunate enough that Laura had me over on Garden Answer to do a video on the Highlights channel. And then just recently, I was one of many gardeners who shared sort of their most impressive plant of the year over there. And that's always fun to work with Aaron and Laura. They're just really generous people. And you guys all know Laura, so I don't have to tell you about her. So 2020 will be for me forever the year of the new naturalistic garden that I made. Not only was that the biggest garden project that I've ever taken on, but also I think I'm the happiest with it. And I think that comes from learning how to pare down a plant palette and how to really spend the time making a design up before I go out there. I mean, I've gone halfway down the road of a design before, but I lose interest in that. And then I'm like, well, I'll just figure it out once I get the plants in. And this year I stuck to it. And I think it's great. Now, it's got a long way to go. Some areas I planted a little bit more sparsely than I would have wanted to, just from a budgetary standpoint. There's other areas of it that I'm going to continue working in the future so that it extends nicely. And we'll have to see how things fare over winter because there will be areas that I'll have to adjust or work in different plants or kind of just see how things roll with that. I will say it was really actually a blessing that I did that in this year of 2020 for two reasons. One, while I don't allow the public to come into my garden, I do occasionally have small groups come for a little tour. And there was a couple of groups who had asked, like little garden clubs, who had asked if they could come over and take a look at it. And there were other people who had wanted to just stop by. And that's a lot of pressure. So if you've ever opened your garden up to somebody, I always say it is maybe the single best thing you can do for your garden is to let other people in your garden, because you see your garden through other people's eyes. And so you see things you might not notice otherwise. It is also hugely stressful because you want everything to look really nice. You don't want there to be, you know, like a big weed over here or something that's not looking right. Because even if they're gardeners, you just want it to look nice. So the pressure was off, and I actually ended up planting that garden much later than I thought I was going to. I planted it at the end of June, and I actually finished it 4th of July weekend. Even though I think I had had all the plants at least a month before, I just kind of took my time with it. And that was a blessing because I enjoyed that process so much. Planting, I love planting. I love rearranging plants in a garden. And I was able to, instead of really rushing through that, I was able to sort of savor that and just have that time to myself. And those are the moments for me that I love the most in the garden. So that garden, I actually revisited that garden for you guys, I think 3 times. I give you 3 separate tours of that just because I was so happy with how it was coming together. And I hope it looks that good next year. We'll see. So while, you know, 2020 was not the year that I think anybody would have hoped for, the garden for me ended up being a place of refuge more so than it usually is. It also became a huge place for our family. When we were not able to get together with our extended family inside because of the pandemic, 3 times we got together by our big old fire pit and just made a giant fire. And we were able to get together there for holidays, which if you had told me that I would spend a portion of Christmas standing around a fire in 15 degrees with my family opening up gifts, I would have thought you were crazy. But you got to do what you got to do, right? And I'm so thankful we had that yard. The weather cooperated, by the way, quite a bit. But how nice to have this space to be able to do that. And I know how fortunate I am to be able to have those moments and this space. And so it's not lost on me that I'm really lucky to have had that. And I'm more thankful for my outdoor spaces this year than I've ever been before in my life. So what's coming up for 2021 in the garden? Well, I don't really know for sure yet. I've just gotten to that point in my gardening year where I've stepped back enough to get some enthusiasm going again. I don't care for winter, but I'm thankful that I live in a place that has winter so that I can get enthusiastic about gardening again by taking a little break from the garden. And I'm just now getting to that point where the ideas are starting to flow. I'm opening up books and magazines and starting to think creatively. And I do have one more video coming up, I think, maybe two in the new year that are going to reference 2020, including one with some more amusing moments in it. And beyond that, we're just going to see what happens. So thank you all for following me in this journey this year. I made about 75 videos this year, which is about 3 times as many as the year before. So many people found the channel this year. I can't thank you enough for hanging out with me, sharing such amazing information in the comments. I encourage everyone to read the comments. In the videos, most of the comments are so full of great information and great suggestions. Some of the things I incorporated in my garden this year were directly based on suggestions that have been made by you, the viewers, and I am so appreciative for that. And I don't say this very often, but if you're watching this video, you like what you saw, if you would like to subscribe to the channel, I would really appreciate that. That helps me out, that helps the channel, and that helps other gardeners find this little community that we're developing here. And so thank you for that. So that's it. Thanks for following along, everyone. We will see you in 2021. Bye.
Confetti on the floor, they're walking out the door. Yeah, all the lights come on, but you are still the one I want. Forget the mess we made, all the things we shouldn't have said. You let your guard down, so I let my guard down too. You are still the one, can't pretend that you're not, so I won't, no I won't. I know we got our problems, but I know we can solve them. 'Cause everyone has gone home, but you still dance with me when the party is over. Problems, well damn it, I don't